Thank you. seated. As you might have guessed, Pete had his hands all over this service. And as you might suspect, Pete was very particular about what would and what wouldn't be included in our worship this afternoon. My name is Tony Sundermeyer. I'm the senior pastor here at First Presbyterian Church of Atlanta. And today, along with my dear friend and colleague, Joanna Adams, I welcome all of you here in the sanctuary, all of you who are worshiping with us remotely via live stream, to this witness to the resurrection and the celebration of the faith and the life of Pete Carrell. On behalf of our session, the entire congregation, my wife Katie, and our sons, we extend our deepest sympathies and our heartfelt prayers to you, dear Carrell family. On a personal note, over the past 7 years, Pete became a trusted confidant and one of the most important encouragers of my ministry here. He also became a dear friend to me. We talked faith, we talked leadership, we talked about money. Cash is king, he'd always say. We talked about racism, we talked about societal challenges, and we talked fundraising, and we talked capital campaigns. We talked about how he changed his mind over the years, how he changed his mind about theology, about social issues. We swapped stories about losing our fathers at an early age and stories of our kidney cancers. He taught me to hunt quail and introduced me to Sea Island, and he loved my children, which is one of the best gifts anybody can give you. I loved him, and I'll miss him. A little over 2 weeks ago, Pete and I sat down to plan this service along with Ada Lee and Elizabeth. He picked the songs. Pete loved church music. And he planned out the rhythm and he planned out the flow of this service. In typical Pete fashion, he even wrote something for me to read, guaranteeing that he will have the final word. That will come later in the service, but for now, let me first say to you, Ada Lee, that we love you and we are praying for you in these days. We love the way that you loved Pete, and we love the way that Pete loved you. And while no marriage is perfect, you were perfect for each other. You made a beautiful and a brilliant life together, and the world will never be the same. Elizabeth and Ken, Austin and Kitty, he loved you, and he celebrated you almost as much as he celebrated your children. Corey and Jake, Catherine, Kaylee, and Pete, there wasn't a visit I had with your grandfather where I wouldn't receive a quick report on how you were doing, what you were doing, and all he wished to celebrate about you. He loved you all so very much. And I would be remiss if I didn't mention his lifelong friend, I think since the second grade, Charlie Five Ash. Friends who grew up in Brunswick and who've stayed friends for so many years. I'd also like to mention his love for you, Tom Bell. You were his best friend, a partner in leisure and business, and of course, the co-conspirator to accomplish the audacious, God-inspired dream to save Grady Hospital. Your friendship meant the world to him. As Christians, when we have a service like this, we have a very discreet purpose. First, we come to worship God. We come to give thanks to God for the faith and the life of Pete Carrell. The very best gifts always come to us wrapped up in flesh. And Pete was one of God's abundant gifts in our lives. Second, we come to surround this family with our love and support. They do not walk this road alone, and by God's grace, we all have the strength to share their grief with them, even as we carry our own. And finally, we claim today in the Christian tradition the promises of God that through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, we no longer fear the grave. Jesus died and was raised from the dead, we proclaim, thus freeing us all from death and granting to us everlasting life. This is the bedrock of the Christian story, and this is the bedrock of Pete's faith. On the final night of his life, Pete, somewhere between awake and asleep, cried out. He woke Ada Lee up, and she came to his side, and Pete kept saying over and over again, "They won't let me through the gates. They won't let me through the gates." And Ada Lee said, "Mr. Pete, you get in there. You make your way through those gates." Well, the gates have finally opened for Pete Carrell. God called him home. And all the saints that have gone before us welcomed him. He walked through those gates, and I am quite confident that the first thing he heard were the words we all long to hear: "Well done, good and faithful servant. Well done." And so today we mark a life well lived. We celebrate a faith that lived life to the full. And today we celebrate the promises of God that were sealed in Pete's baptism. Because Christ lives, Pete lives. Even though we only see in a mirror dimly now, we will one day see face to face. So as we continue our time of worship this afternoon, we engage in a practice essential to our community of faith. It's the practice of confession. It's an opportunity that we take every time we gather to be honest before God and honest before one another. And so I'd invite you to stand in body or in spirit. And I invite you to join with me in the printed prayer of confession in your order for worship. Gracious God, our sins are too heavy to carry, too real to hide, and too deep to undo. Forgive what our lips tremble to name, what our hearts can no longer bear, and what has become for us a consuming fire of judgment. Set us free from a past that we cannot change. Open to us a future in which we can be changed, and grant us grace to grow more and more in your likeness and image, through Jesus Christ, the light of the world. Amen. Friends, God's life-giving word and spirit conquer the powers of sin and death. Believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Alleluia. Amen. I'd invite you to open your hymnals to number 625, "How Great Thou Art."
Thank you. Hear now this reading from God's Word from the book of Revelation, found at the conclusion of the New Testament. Listen for God's Word. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from heaven from God, prepared as a bride for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the dwelling place of God is with mortals. He will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself will be with them. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death shall be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the former things will have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I make all things new." And he also said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true. It is done. I'm the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Giving thanks to God for the life of one whom we have loved and honored and lost is one of life's greatest privileges. And I'm so grateful to be here as a part of this service of celebration of Pete Carrell's life and to claim on his behalf the promise of the resurrection to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. For 30 years, I have been close to Ada Lee and Pete and to their people. They're wonderful people, marrying their children, baptizing their grandchildren, the weddings, the baptisms, the anniversaries, the building dedications. Lord, the building dedications. The events, great and small, joyful and heartbreaking. I was there for so many of them. And Pete was so often there for me. I served as the family pastor for 10 or 11 years. And when I would come to a prickly problem that really stumped me as how I should address it, I sort of had Pete's number on speed dial. I would call him at Georgia Pacific. He'd say, "Come down for lunch." And he would say it just like that. And I would go. And before we'd buttered our rolls, he had figured out how I ought to solve the problem. That was Pete. I wish he were around to help us solve the problem of how to press on without him. He's been such a given in our lives and in the life of Atlanta and the life of Georgia in so many ways. As Tony mentioned, he did leave instructions as to how he wanted this service to go. And what was so striking to me was his strong emphasis, wasn't it, Elizabeth, on how he did not want much carrying on. So I never was afraid of Pete, but I always thought it was a good thing to do what he thought would be good. So I just want to take a moment to share an aspect about him that some of you might not be so deeply aware of, and that's the matter of his personal faith. Now, Pete and piety did not go together so well. But he loved his Lord, and he was a man of faith. He loved especially being a Presbyterian, a tradition that emphasizes that God is not just Lord of the church, but that God is involved with the broader realms of culture and society. And because those are God's concerns, we absolutely have to do that too, because that's what we were put on this earth for. And I will say, having been in two congregations where Pete and Ada Lee were members, I can say if they were able to walk, they were in church on Sunday morning. They just were people, are people that go to church. It's what they do. Now, I can attest to the presence of the Correls in church. I cannot say that Pete sang every word of every hymn. Neither can I say, sorry, Tony, I don't think he listened to every word of every sermon. And I've heard it said that he sometimes might miss the benediction depending on whether the Atlanta Falcons were playing in the afternoon. But I do know one thing for sure. He prayed the Lord's Prayer, especially these words: Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. And how do I know that? Because of the life that he lived. To paraphrase the great Methodist John Wesley, Pete Correll did all he could in every way that he could with all the energy and creativity and brilliance that he had to make earth as much like heaven as he possibly could. All over, everywhere, he loved this city. He worked tirelessly in every imaginable way on behalf of so many great institutions. He raised hundreds of millions of dollars for his beloved Grady Hospital. I won't go through the list. One reason Pete didn't want too much carrying on is that he knew you all knew what all he'd done. He wanted this to be about God and the goodness and the majesty of God and the promises of God. He loved his city. He loved his state. Al and I spend a lot of time down in Glenn County these days, and I'm telling you, Glenn County would be, I don't know what would happen to Glenn County if it hadn't been for Pete. Oh my goodness, everywhere. Things you don't even know about. Little things, big things. I'm thinking 680 acres that he saved from development on St. Simon's Island alone. He and his friends making it happen. Pete wanted it to happen if it was good. He wanted everyone to be able to live a whole and fulfilled life. He saw God's vision of the good, and he spent his life doing what he could to make it come to be on earth as it is in heaven. No more tears, no more crying, no more pain. Push back death as far as you can. Stop suffering. Stand on the side of life in its fullness. He saw the vision, and he knew we could do better than we do. And what I love is that he was always ahead of us. Always ahead of us. Well, Pete, I don't know. But then we'd see the light. We do what Pete saw, and it would be good. So I close with this. I didn't actually hear it, but I can really realistically imagine the conversation Pete Correll had with his Creator God. It was short and succinct, as were most conversations with Pete. Here's what the Lord said. Pete, I'm going to reveal the good to you, and then I'm going to give you what you need to get it done. On Pete's side, taciturn Pete, this was his answer. Okay, Lord. He was quite a fella. May his tribe increase in this city and in this state and in our beloved nation and in our world. Whatever good we do, may we always give the glory to God. Amen.
Amen. Pete said, I want in the garden, and it's got to be a baritone. Thank you, Wade. I met Pete and Ada Lee right here in this sanctuary. It was August of 2014, my first month in this pulpit. Pete and Natalie started attending First Presbyterian Church of Atlanta about 12 months prior when Joanna Adams became the interim senior pastor. She came out of retirement following Dr. George Worth's retirement before I came. As Joanna mentioned, she was the family pastor at one of our sister congregations here in town. And truth be told, there was no minister on the planet that Pete held in higher esteem than you. So much so that when Joanna did come out of retirement to be the interim here, Pete and Ada Lee followed her. After meeting the Carells at worship that day, Joanna called me in the afternoon and said, "You really ought to reach out to Pete and Ada Lee. Pete's a lifelong Presbyterian, they're a wonderful couple, and they're thinking about joining First Presbyterian." Now, what you need to know about me is that I'm from Philadelphia. We had just moved from Philly to Atlanta that month, and I was born and raised in the city, so I had a little bit of a learning curve when it came to understanding the Atlanta context and getting to know not just our church members and our church family, but also the influencers and difference makers in the city. So heeding Joanna's advice, I reached out to Pete and Ada Lee, and they invited me to join them for lunch at the Downtown Club the day after Labor Day. As I mentioned, I'm from Philly, which means I am a big Philadelphia sports fan. Don't hold it against me. The day before our lunch, I had gone to watch the Phillies and the Braves play at Turner Field. The Phillies actually won the game, and for the 11th time in Major League Baseball history, they pitched a combined no-hitter. So during our lunch, Pete asked if I was going to change my rooting interests now that I was here in Atlanta. And I said, "Pete, that's going to be really hard for me to do." And then I proceeded, for some reason, to go on and on about how the Phillies just no-hit the Braves the day before and how awesome that was. And Pete just sat there quietly as I gloated and boasted about my team. He didn't say a word. Now, it's not lost on me that this was a terrible church growth strategy if you're going to pastor an Atlanta church, but I couldn't help myself. We finished lunch and we began to walk out of the club. And as we passed the bar, two men were sitting there and they noticed Pete and they called out his name. They said, "Hey, Pete." And Pete turned to them and he said, "Hey, John. Hey, Frank. How are you?" The men got out of their chairs. They moved toward us and they began to strike up a conversation. What was so odd in this particular moment is that Pete did not introduce me to these two men. I mean, I was standing right there next to Ada Lee, next to Pete, and surely it was right to expect that this southern gentleman would introduce us. "This is my soon-to-be new pastor," or, "This is the new senior minister at First Presbyterian Church in Midtown," but nothing. They wrapped up their brief conversation. We walked toward the door, and then Pete stopped us. He turned to me, and he said, "Tony, you might be wondering why I did not introduce you to those two men." And I said, "Pete, yeah, that was a little odd." He said, "The reason I didn't introduce you was because that was the president and the general manager of the Atlanta Braves, and I was afraid of what you might say to them." I thought that was both fair and wise. To be sure, Pete had the gift of wisdom. Not just the gift of intelligence, but he had the gift of wisdom, the kind of wisdom that's described for us in Proverbs 3. "Happy are those who find wisdom and those who get understanding, for her income is better than silver and her revenue better than gold. She's more precious than jewels, and nothing you desire can compare with her. Long life is in her right hand, in her left hand are riches and honor." Pete Carell was wise. He didn't just have a keen business savvy, he also had an incredibly high emotional intelligence. He was wise with people. He knew who he could trust. He knew who he could turn to. He had an instinct for who he ought to invest in and who he ought to mentor. And when Pete made an investment in you, when he made an investment in an institution, an investment in an idea or a cause, he was all in. He was ready to serve. He was ready to empower. He was ready to make a difference that would change your life and even change the world. As you know, Pete Carrell wasn't only wise, he also had a servant's heart. When I think of Pete, I think of those famous words from the 24th chapter of Joshua, "Choose this day whom you will serve." And Pete made his choice. "As for me and my household, we will serve the Lord." Pete and I would meet regularly throughout our seven-year friendship. One day we were having lunch at Chops, and Pete was a little ornery and a bit restless. You know how he could get. He said, "Tony, I don't feel useful in the church. Nobody's asked me to serve on session. No one's asked me to do anything." I said, "Pete, would you like to serve on session?" He said, "Hell no." I said, "How about a committee?" He said, "No way." I said, "Pete, I know you like hymns. How about singing in the choir?" "You got to be kidding me." So I asked him, what do you want to do?" He said, "I'm not exactly sure, but I know I want to be useful, Tony. I want to be useful." This was one of his greatest qualities. He wanted to contribute. He wanted to make a difference. He was earnest and sincere in his desire to serve God and to serve his fellow human beings, whether it was through his church or Grady Hospital or at UGA or in Brunswick or on the Georgia coast, or by quietly supporting students whose names you will never know in financing their education. He wanted to make an impact in the lives and the communities he loved, in the lives and the communities he cared for. Right about the time we had this conversation, we were on the verge of launching a transformational plan for our campus here at the corner of 16th and Peachtree, a plan like many things that got put on hold because of COVID, but is now back on track. Like most things this church does, this plan is outward facing, curating a greater sense of hospitality and fellowship for our neighbors here in Midtown, investing significant dollars in our community ministries, which serves over 1,000 of our most vulnerable friends in the city, and plans for an 11-story workforce housing project right across the street. And so I invited Pete to join that effort. I invited him to lend his wisdom and his guidance to this process, and he said yes. I invited him to mentor me and to help me avoid the pitfalls and pain of a project of this magnitude. And he was there giving me counsel, as Joanna referenced earlier. He invested in the project and he invested in my leadership. He was always willing to meet. He was always willing to listen. And of course, he was always ready to tell me what I should do. And 99 times out of 100, he was right. And I know, as Joanna's story and my story, I know there are thousands of other stories just like that, of how Pete invested in our lives, how he invested in your life, stories of how Pete made a difference. I think of Emerson's line, "The purpose of life is not to be happy, it's to be useful. It's to be honorable, to be compassionate, to have it make some difference that you've lived and that you've lived well." Pete was useful. Pete was honorable. Pete was compassionate. Pete made a difference. And Pete lived life well. And all of this was rooted in his sense that he was here to serve God, to serve his family, to serve his community, and to serve this world. He will be remembered as someone who chose to serve God by serving us. It's true, Pete Carrell was wise. Pete Carrell possessed a desire to serve God and a desire to be useful. And finally, Pete Carrell believed with his whole being He believed in the providential purposes of God. Pete read the circumstances of his life through the lens of purpose. He read the hardship. He read the days growing up in poverty and in Brunswick. He read the losses. He read the pain. He read the illness. He read the challenges. He read the successes. He read the wealth, the opportunities. He read the relationships. He read his family and all the accomplishments that came his way. He read all of it through the lens of purpose. If there was a life verse for Pete Carrell, I think it would be 1 Corinthians 7:17. I really do believe it summarizes the essence of his life. It reads, "Let each of you lead the life that the Lord has assigned, to which God called you." Pete truly believed that God loved him and that God called him for a purpose. And as you'll hear in his own words in just a few moments, Pete did not believe in happenstance. He truly believed that God was at work. He truly believed that God was leading him, that God was preparing him, empowering him, and infusing his life with meaning. Pete believed that God was involved in human history. He believed in providence. He believed that God cooperates with the people who God created to work in the world to accomplish God's divine will. He believed that human beings could have a relationship with the divine that enables us to share in this work and to press on, that God can use even us to carry out God's mission in and for the world. Pete believed that we could trust God's plan, that we could trust our lives into God's care, and that God would indeed guide us and direct us, that God's ultimate purposes would be fulfilled in human history. And despite human depravity and despite human sin, Pete believed that God's ultimate reign, the vision that Joanna read about in Revelation 21, he believed that it was possible and he worked for it. On our way to that future, we can trust in God's providence the way that Pete did. Providence to sustain us and to draw us into God's purposes. Because the work of the Spirit, God guides us and guides our lives and keeps our life and sends us out into the world that God so loves. Pete really did believe this. It anchored his life. And if he left us anything in his legacy, he left us this: the challenge and the encouragement to believe. To believe in what is possible, to believe in the good, and to believe that God's purposes will win the day, to believe that God does, in fact, have a plan for your life, to believe God will give us the wisdom to discern that plan and the wisdom to invite others to join us on that road, to believe God will help us to be useful in accomplishing God's purposes. To believe that our life is in fact infused with meaning and infused with purpose. So may we all see Pete's life as a testimony to these truths and to honor him and his legacy, to carry it on into the future. May we all have a vision of what is possible. May we all have a vision of what God is calling us to do. And may we, like Pete Carrell, actually do it. For the sake of the gospel and for the sake of the world, may it be so in our lives. Amen.
Let us bow our heads for prayer. Most gracious God, before you, generations rise and pass away. We praise you for all whom we have loved and lost, who now live eternally with you. Mothers and fathers, grandparents, friends, great leaders, humble servants, teachers, pastors, we remember them with gratitude now before you. We praise you especially for the one and only Pete Carell, whose baptism is now complete in his death. We're grateful for his life, for all about him that was good and brave, wise and loving, generous and visionary. We recall his deep love for his wonderful Ada Lee, the strength of their marriage across the years. We're grateful for Austin and Kitty, for Elizabeth and Ken, and for the beloved grandchildren, Pete and Kaylee and Catherine, Jake and Corey, each of whom so precious to him. We think of his exceptional tenacity and brilliance of mind, and for all about him that made him special, but also for those things about Pete that made him a regular guy, for his love of sassy cars and stylish clothes, for his love of boats and hunting and a good glass of bourbon. We remember that behind his sometimes rough demeanor lay, without a doubt, the softest heart in Georgia. We pray that you would comfort all of us who grieve his death, that we might be filled with that peace that is beyond our human understanding. Show us your grace, O God, in the days ahead, that as we come to terms with the mystery of death, we may see the light of eternity remind us of the unshakable grounding of our faith that in life and in death, we belong to you through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Before I read Pete's final words to us, I want to give just a little bit of logistical instruction. We're delighted to have the Georgia Brass Quintet. Four out of the five are at UGA, which is very apropos, and they have a sub right from next door at the Atlanta Symphony Orchestra. Gentlemen, thank you for being here. Pete wanted When the Saints Go Marching In to close the day, and we're so grateful that you're lending your gifts to that wish. So the family will be escorted out by Joanna Adams, followed by the casket. I'm going to invite you to remain in the sanctuary, standing or sitting when that time comes. And then the family is going to greet folks for about an hour, just to invite folks who have come from out of town to go first. We really want to encourage that. If you're in town, if you see the family in a regular way, know that you're going to see them soon. We'd really encourage you to let those out-of-town guests come through the line. That line is going to form right over here. Once you see me head down that way, that'll be your cue to start forming a line. You'll go right across the room. We have hospitality folks who will guide you in to greet the family. And again, they know that we're not going to have a chance to have everyone be greeted, but we do hope, especially for those out-of-town guests, that they're able to come through the line first. So Pete's final words. Thank you for coming. Since Tony is reading this note, I must be dead. But there are a few things I want to say to you. Please don't be sad. I've led a rich, full life, driven by three things. First, I am a predestined Presbyterian. All my life, I've known that God put me on this earth to do something. I just never really knew what that was. Clearly, Grady was it. How else can you explain a poor southern boy raised by a single parent in Brunswick, Georgia, never having been to Atlanta, Georgia, being the catalyst to drive Grady? God must have been preparing me for this my whole life. Think about it. This poor boy led a group of Atlanta businessmen to save Grady Hospital. How unthinkable is that? Especially without a plan. When people say to me, God does not have a plan for everyone's life, I want to laugh in their face. When God led me all over the USA, he was preparing me for one task, saving Grady. That was 70 years after I was born. That, ladies and gentlemen, is the definition of long-term planning. And what God has in store for you in your life, if you choose to follow his direction. The second thing in my life was a strong mother. My father died when I was 12 years old. He was a nice man, but he was an abusive alcoholic. We were bankrupt and were too dumb to know it. So mother and I set about paying all of our bills and running a men's store in Brunswick, Georgia. That experience taught me well the value of cash, which business students never understand. They can read a balance sheet and income statement, but can't read a cash flow statement. There's nothing more sobering than looking in the cash drawer at the end of the day and seeing if there was more or less money in it than when the day began. That premise, taught at Carell's Men's Shop, drove my whole business career. Nothing matters but cash. The third driving force in my life, another strong woman, Ada Lee. A sweet young girl from Swainsboro, Georgia, who believed that everything would always be all right in life. A true Pollyanna. I moved her all over the country, from Georgia to Virginia to Maine to North Carolina to Arkansas to Seattle to Dayton, Ohio, and finally back to Atlanta. All the time, she kept saying, "This is what God had planned for you. If this is what God has planned for you, Pete, say yes." It got so I would come home from work and say, "Honey, we're moving." Not even asking where, she'd start packing. The Carells, two small children, and a dog would take off. When you ask Alston and Elizabeth where they're from, they are stumped. They've been exposed to so many places and situations. My home has become where the four are. Not a given place with a given name. Tony will be at the side door accepting memberships to the Presbyterian Church. That's really in there, Joanna. And may God be with you, and may you always know I led the perfect life, and it's time for me to leave the field of play. God bless you. I'd invite you to stand. Friends, may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, a peace that Pete knows in full measure, may it guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. May it live inside of you this day and every day ahead. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you.